Half a day, Maniluhu, Sidzuus Maasi, Namangagi Hamzu Gwinipaku. On behalf of our people, I'm very excited to present Decolonization 101, The Quest for Self-Governance, a film that explores how Guam's status as an unincorporated territory continues to affect our everyday lives and limit our growth and potential as an island. By definition, Indigenous peoples are the holders of unique languages, knowledge systems, and beliefs. Indigenous peoples possess invaluable knowledge of practices for the sustainable management of our natural resources. This means that if you are Indigenous, then you are the future. There are as little as 500 million Indigenous peoples in roughly 90 countries worldwide, which make up only 5% of the entire global population. You are that 5%. We are Indigenous, and we are still here in spite of the odds. Today, we honor our past and those who will come after us. But we must also remember that every day is an opportunity to celebrate our identity, even as we battle the injustices imposed on us. We must continue to persevere as our ancestors have before us. Mungahin mana falingu animu put inina atsaki. Man met gotnyahid kita hasu. Hita tauto guahan.
Self-determination is a right of a people to determine their political destiny as a people. It is a right of people and not of land. In Guam's case, the Chamorro people, the indigenous people of Guam, who have been promised this right, has this right of self-determination. It is an inalienable right, meaning that it cannot be bought, it can't be sold, and neither can it be transferred.
The Chamorro people have inhabited the Mariana Islands for over 4,000 years. But in the last 500 years of their history, the people have been subjected to colonization that has impacted every aspect of their lives. As a Spanish colony, the people of Guam endured a violent period of war and disease brought by the Spanish, followed by non-democratic U.S. naval government rule and a brutal Japanese occupation during World War II. Under the Treaty of Paris, the international treaty that transferred Guam from Spain to the United States, the U.S. Congress was deemed solely responsible for advancing the civil and political rights of the native inhabitants of Guam. Though Guam has made major strides in creating an organized system of government, as an unincorporated territory of the United States, Guam remains subject to the unilateral control of the federal government, meaning that decisions affecting their island can be made by people 8,000 miles away, with no input or consent from the colonized people of Guam. Because they do not have meaningful representation in the American political system, they are not empowered to make decisions for themselves, and they are not treated equally or given the same rights as other U.S. citizens in the United States.
Quite simply, it just means that you are a possession but not a part of the United States. It's a legal definition. It means that we are not on the path to statehood. That's what unincorporated territory means.
Right now, we have to follow the guidelines that are given to us from the United States. And it doesn't matter if those guidelines are applicable to Guam or not. We have to follow them. And we're following things that are not culturally sensitive to us. We're following things that are kind of backwards when you apply it to our island. but we don't have the choice.
To be an unincorporated territory of the United States essentially means that we are living in a jurisdiction that does not have full rights of democracy.
An unincorporated territory of the United States means that you are a possession of the United States. There's a lot of nice ways that we can put it. We can call ourselves Guam, where America's day begins. We can call ourselves Guam, America, and Asia. But unincorporated territory reminds you that despite all the nice ways you dress it up, the U.S. considers you to be owned property.
An unincorporated territory is a palatable construction. It's something that legitimizes something that shouldn't exist any longer, which is in essence a modern-day colony.
The United States is not recognizing us as the indigenous people of these islands, of the Marianas.
Sovereignty is a human right that every person should have. Sovereignty is the ability to govern yourself and to make all decisions for you. Currently, as an unincorporated territory, Guam is not sovereign. Therefore, that basic human right is violated in the nature of the type of political status we have.
It has been very disheartening to know that because we are not sovereign and because we are a territory of the United States, we're dictated a lot about what happens here.
70 years ago, when the United States came back and liberated the Chamorro people from the Japanese, they were extremely overwhelmed with gratitude. So much so that the United States took advantage of their hospitality and their gratitude, and to this day have not paid fair restitution and have not given us a fair say in how we want our island to be. They continue to dictate to us how things should be done in our island.
There are a number of different examples of how our democracy is not exercised or we are not given the right to full governance. And so, for example, the most obvious one that oftentimes is a subject of discussion is our inability to vote for the United States president. We have an elected official who we don't get to participate in electing. So in that regard, the very basic civil right of voting for that particular position is not made available to us.
Chamorros were assured in the Treaty of Paris when the Spaniards and the Americans signed the end of the Spanish-American War and transferred jurisdiction of Guam from Spain to the United States. The progression, the political progression of the people was guaranteed, but how have we gone forward from that? My grandparents were not born U.S. citizens, and then magically overnight, one morning, they woke up and they were. There was no vote, there was no informed consent. They went through a war without, you know, having any part in that. It's always these extenuating circumstances made from the outside, and that is just unhuman to do. And so, yes, Chamorro people's rights are being trampled on a daily.
We have no voting representation in Congress. It's just completely unfair to our people. Why then should we have a representative there who would otherwise assist all the other policymakers from other states who get to push their own agendas? And then when it comes to us, really, it's a matter of lobbying for support, you know, building up our fanfare, I guess, to support the people of Guam. Anytime we're, you know, looking for any measure of success or ways to progress.
So I interned at the Commission on Decolonization over the summer. And during the time, there was a lot of conflict with the Department of Defense, with the military on Guam, in regards to the Cerianthus nelsoni tree, which is like one of the last remaining tree species on Guam. And it was said to be bulldozed and destroyed in this military project for a live firing training range. So there was an outcry in the community. Senators passed this resolution in the legislature, basically asking for a pause. And then it also got to the governor. The governor also sent a letter out asking for a pause to the military officials. And The response was basically a resounding no, that they will not discontinue the buildup, they will not discontinue the construction, and that they felt that they were implementing sufficient amounts of like adapting measures to protect the tree. And it showed that the military, at the end of the day, no matter how great of a community partner they are to us, has a unilateral control over what happens over the lands, our resources, and ultimately the health of the environment and our people.
I remember being at the Mingilao mayor's office, and there was a public hearing in regards to the military buildup. And I remember I was going up to the mic and they're asking us to provide comment and testimony on why we don't agree with the buildup, or just to voice our concerns, you know, listen to us, do their part. And I remember just being so angry and upset, because here I am, like, crying at the mic, saying, like, I don't want you to extend your boot prints. You know, you're contaminating our land. There's been so much contamination already happening. I don't want this buildup to happen. And I felt like they were just staring at us, like, okay, we're just gonna listen to you and then move on and do what we need to do. And that was just so disheartening to me, to have to go to every single one of these hearings and just have them listen to us cry and really release our anger and frustration over something we don't have any control over. As a community, like, we have been entrusted this land from, you know, our ancestors and those that have come before us, and how to be best stewards of our land. You know, historically, we have known how to take care of the ocean, of the land, and ways that we have sustained for generations. So we are given that inherent right when we are born.
Following World War II, the United Nations created a list of 72 non-self-governing territories whose people have not yet attained a full measure of self-government. The people of most of these territories have already exercised their right to self-determination and have successfully decolonized. The neighboring islands of the Micronesian region have all exercised their right to self-determination. The colonized people of Guam have not, and remain one of the last 17 non-self-governing territories as recognized by the UN and the United States. Self-determination is a universal, sacred, and inalienable human right, and gives the colonized people of Guam an opportunity to decide their own political destiny. With an exercise of self-determination, the colonized people of Guam express how they wish to define their relationship with the United States, whether as a state of the U.S., in free association with the U.S., or as an independent country.
All people everywhere have the right to determine what their destiny is.
Self-determination is the ability to make decisions as a people about your political future.
It's really about realizing that we as a people, we ought to have the same position as every other nation and every other country to negotiate for ourselves all the decisions that are made globally that have an impact on our people.
Self-determination is ultimately about having the ability to make our own decisions for ourselves, whether that's good or bad. It's ultimately having the power to determine our own destiny and our own fate.
We should have the opportunity to take a critical lens to our system of government and figure out what works for our people and what doesn't. It's our responsibility to examine and explore what are those possibilities and how could this change? How could we improve this? And then from there, that then becomes our choice. After we have all of this education, after we really understand what the current status means, what does it entail, and then what do these other status options provide or offer to us, now we have to make a decision. Now we have to decide, okay, for ourselves, what do we want?
Guam law says that only native inhabitants of Guam are qualified to participate in a self-determination referendum. What that means is that anyone whose ancestors or they themselves were made a U.S. citizen by virtue of the 1950 Organic Act of Guam. So essentially, what Congress did was throw a net around everyone living in Guam in 1950. And so basically that entire group and their descendants are all considered native inhabitants of Guam, and they all get to vote. They alone get to exercise the right of self-determination. They get to choose one of three internationally recognized options.
Decolonization is much greater than just a vote on political status. It is the colonized people asserting their inherent right to govern themselves and make decisions in their homeland. Decolonization is changing the way that colonized peoples think and see themselves. It's reaching into your minds and reimagining what your colonizers have led you to believe about yourselves. It is taking your challenges, finding new solutions, and empowering your people to make the changes that you wish to see. Decolonization is pushing back against the idea that Guam is too small, too isolated, too insignificant to govern itself, and demanding that the colonized people be given the same dignity and respect as everyone else. The indigenous people of Guam, who have endured almost 500 years of uninterrupted colonization, deserve the dignity of being able to decide for themselves what they want their political destiny to be.
The idea of decolonization is changing your situation if you are a colony so that you have more political power and strength. For me, decolonization is sovereignty. Sovereignty means the ability to have a say in all decisions made on your behalf. So sovereignty is self-rule or self-governance. Currently, Guam does not govern itself alone. We do have a local government, but Congress reserves all final decisions, so Congress can override any of our laws, can make any decisions for the island that we can't change.
It's the coming out party. It's the bar mitzvah, it's the sweet 16, it's the graduation. It's opening the door and allowing us to grow to our full potential or fail and learn from our mistakes.
I think in a practical sense, decolonization is reclaiming ownership of what we value most. It is our commitment to create government and a quality of life that is acceptable for us. I look at the colonial status, the current status, as a status that we have settled on.
Decolonization is the right of a group of people that live in a defined area to be able to freely determine for themselves how they want to exist, what form of government they want, what kinds of laws they want to pass, how resources are going to be managed and used in their respective territory. It affords the right of a group of people to move forward in their destiny as they see fit, without external pressure or without mandate of another foreign power.
What colonization really does is it takes you out of the world. It traps you in time. As the rest of the world changes and progresses and adapts, you're stuck because you can't change with it, because the colonizer dictates what you can and can't do. Even if you don't feel it all the time, the colonizer sets up this invisible wall around you, so you can't be friends with those around you unless the colonizer says so. But even as the colonizer itself, as they're advancing, they keep you in check. They don't allow you to grow. And so decolonization is important because it means Guam can join the world. It means Guam can join the United States as a real member of the United States, a real part of the Union. I mean, think about this. How can we say that we are proud to be Americans when the person that we vote to go to Congress does not even have a vote?
Part of our challenge is that we have to be educated about what the current status means and what these other models mean. And we have to decide for ourselves what's gonna be best for us. Because nothing is just gonna change overnight, right? I mean, we're always gonna go through some growing pains. I mean, that's just what it is. We went through growing pains to get here under this status. It took us a while to figure out how to work this status to our advantage. And it has not been easy. But I would argue that we're much better at dealing with our current status in 2019 than we were back when they first signed the Organic Act.
It means that, hey, no matter what Supreme Court decisions are made, or how the Ninth District feels. That's a decision that we have to make for ourselves.
A lot of people see decolonization in the opposite. They think that, okay, decolonization means Guam will become a third world country, will be shut off to the world. But in fact, Guam's role as an unincorporated territory has actually shut us out from the world because we don't participate in the conversations that the world is having about things, like I said, like the economy.
How dangerous is it for public health now that the U.S. has withdrawn from the World Health Organization?
I think from a global perspective, what we learned from this virus is that what happens in other parts of the country can dramatically impact the United States and the U.S. economy.
There are things like, for example, climate change.
The president notified the rest of the world again yesterday that 1 year from now, the day after the 2020 elections, the U.S. will formally withdraw from the Paris Climate Agreement.
The rest of our region is able to get funding to combat climate change or the impacts of climate change. Guam doesn't have that ability because the United States represents us in those forums.
Political decolonization for Guam means that we'll finally have more autonomy, more self-governance. We'll be an equal actor to other sovereign bodies.
Guam public law, as guided by the United Nations Resolution 1541, recognizes three political status options in Guam's quest for decolonization: statehood, free association with the United States, and independence. Established in 1997, the Commission on Decolonization was created with three political status task forces to lead the educational campaign in preparation for Guam's decolonized future.
The three internationally recognized options are independence, free association, or full integration, which we sometimes just in shorthand call statehood. The international community has already made a very profound decision, and they have decided that colonialism is a crime. The very enterprise of colonization is considered abhorrent to the international legal order. The right of self-determination belongs to what's called an exalted class of legal norms. Essentially, these are rules that are considered so sacrosanct, so sacred, that no state is allowed to derogate from them. No country is allowed to violate these rights. And colonization is now considered illegal. That's exactly why to have conversations about how the status quo is an acceptable option flies in the face both of history and law. Opinions about the law are not law, you know? The law is settled, and the law says that self-determination is a fundamental right precisely because colonialism is a condition of unjust relations that has absolutely no place in the modern world.
For me, the best option and the safest option is statehood, because what that would do is that would solidify our relationship with the United States, granting us full membership to the United States and giving us the respect and the opportunities to control ourselves, to govern ourselves, of course, within the Constitution. And for me, that's the best bet, because we have the safety and security of the United States and still maintaining that relationship, but with all the freedoms that every other state in the U.S. has and all the opportunities that we want for ourselves.
Free association is an independent country that chooses from the get-go to have a special relationship with another country. There are very few examples of this. Of course, our neighbors in the region all are freely associated with the United States. And what that would mean is Guam would continue on with a lot of the programs and relationships that we have with our American counterparts as we do today, but would have the freedom of determining how our economy is going to function, who we're going to trade with, what our political alliances will be, bearing in mind that we have a special relationship and responsibility with the United States.
I
I like independence because it would afford Guam the most flexibility and the most freedom. And so when we look at Guam today, there's a lot of restrictions, a lot of ways in which how we live, how our society is set up, the systems of life, they don't really match the fact that we're an island people, the fact that we live on an island, the fact that we're on the edge of Asia. And so we're inhibited in a lot of ways. And so for me, independence would be the best option. The best part about it would be that we would be able to determine and decide what might fit best with our lives out here. And that's why I think is sort of the strongest point for independence is that we're not stuck with whatever the United States is doing. We're not stuck with whatever the United States wants for us. We can have a say over sort of what we think is best for the land and the people here.
Generations come and generations will pass, but if no generation has the courage, the conscience, and the conviction to right the wrongdoings of the past, then the next generation will have to live with the same injustice in the future. How can the people of Guam, the indigenous people of Chamorro, survive under colonial rule, imperialist laws, the subjugation of our people for the past 400 years? We have suffered much in the hands of the colonizer.
I believe that decolonization is inevitable. And the process is not something that's going to happen in one day, in one plebiscite vote, in one night. It's a movement, and it's not a marathon, and it's not a lifetime. It's several lifetimes. The process is going to take, and right now, what I believe we're doing is starting the foundation. The foundation to educate people what our status is now and why we deserve better.
I believe that it's possible, and I'm gonna maintain that belief, and I keep manifesting that in my daily life and in my children's life, and to pass it on. So I believe that in our day, we're gonna see a decolonization happen on Guam. And I see so many beautiful people involved in the movement and that are working really hard to make that a possibility.
Working for decolonization is about thinking about future generations. It's a long-term concern for numerous generations of Chamorros that will come to have a better tomorrow, to have a better life, to have a better society.
We're up against lots of challenges, no doubt. But I want to mention that while most of what we're talking about is the political decolonization process, there also is a very important parallel sort of personal decolonization process. We can do that in terms of reclaiming our history, retelling our stories, you know, in terms of reaching out, for example, to people in the CNMI who culturally we're one, and it is only through the process of colonization that we were separated. You know, there's lots of different ways that we can reinfuse and actually activate even before the political decolonization happens to reclaim our sense of self.
I see decolonization in my lifetime because we are learning quickly now. We have greater access to information. Indigenous people around the world right now are all facing their own battles. As possessions.
I think it is very possible that Guam can decolonize. We have to be very cautious though, because there are ways in which we can pursue decolonization, but then it may not happen there. There may be something that is offered instead, which will kind of keep us stuck in the same place.
Decolonization isn't just something that's set for a group of people, for a group of politicians. Decolonization is something that happens within each and every human mind and heart. And it happens every day. When a baby is born, they are born free. It's only our own constraints that we've put on ourselves and or allow ourselves to live under that puts us in the situation that we are. And so Every day, people decolonize, and little by little, people decolonize. It's not something that can happen overnight. I think as you look at Chamorro literature, Chamorro dance, Chamorro art forms, Chamorro films, you will see the progression of people slowly but surely changing their worldview. And with each generation, that worldview will change. And it's a good thing because we live in an interconnected world, and it's important that in that interconnectedness that we don't lose who we are as a people, that we don't lose ourselves.